church. I hope you're enjoying this nice, crisp, winter, snowy day. We had a present the other day, and it made everything look all nice and white and clean. Just a reminder of what God is going to do or is doing in our lives if we choose to let him do that. He'll make us clean. There are a couple of things for Ministry Matters today. One thing, there's going to be a baptism next Sabbath, so we encourage all of you that can to be here for that. Also, church board members, keep an eye on your emails. There is an email coming out which is a vote that needs to be taken and voted on, so if you could attend to that promptly, that would be appreciated. Also, just as a reminder, we want to remind people after the worship service to please remain seated and be dismissed by the deacon and exit through the main church door only. And I think that's it as far as Ministry Matters. Thank you.
Together. Lord Jesus, like the angels who came from near and from far, like the wise men who came, we come today to worship you.
Yes.
Father, we thank you for sending Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior. Holy Spirit, please be with us today, and may our worship be acceptable before you. We thank you and we praise you in Christ's name. Amen. Amen.
Good morning again. I want to welcome each and every one of you here today, those that are here in person, those that are watching from home on your TV or device. I want to welcome each of you here. It's a beautiful Sabbath day.
a little on the cool side or refreshing, as my friend has mentioned. But again, we want to welcome you and give God the honor and glory that he's brought us through another week. Welcome.
Amen.
Everybody, it's time for the children's story. So we've had two snowstorms now. We've had a big one and we've had a small one, the small one being the first one. And I'm going to tell you this story, and I'll tie it all together when I'm done. But so when the first snowstorm was coming, the first thing I did is I went out back to start my snowblower and plugged it in, turned it on, the thing fired right up and it ran great, no problem. I hit the thing to make sure I went forward and backward, no problem. And then I hit the auger that makes the thing spin and the cable snapped. So I thought, this is gonna be a pain in the neck having to take care of a snowstorm without my snowblower, but I'm blessed in the fact that a mile down the road is my older brother. I have four-wheel drive, so when the snow came, he did his driveway. I was able to take my truck down, put his snowblower in my truck, and then snowblow the driveway in my house. So what I did was I ordered the cables, and I ordered all the cables for my snowblower. So if anything breaks, I'm covered on everything. Mm. Every cable came in except for the auger cable.
Oh, my
That's the only one that got back ordered. So I was talking to a friend I work with, and we had this big storm coming up where I live up in towns, and we got about 18 inches of snow. And my friend from work said to me, Jeff, my sister passed away, and what he got from her was a John Deere tractor with a snowblower attachment to it. He said, I have that if you would like to take my snowblower, take it. So he had this beast of a snowblower. It's huge and it works great. It's on tracks, it's not even on wheels. I was able to go to his house and get his snowblower to do this last storm, the big storm. So my brother had his, I had mine. I didn't have to worry about getting out in the middle of the storm to pick anything up. Everything was taken care of, everybody was covered. I tell you this story, kids, because I want you to understand that heaven is not going to be full of just Seventh-day Adventists. My older brother is not a Seventh-day Adventist, and neither is my friend from work. These are people who are just kind men, who have a good heart, and who love people, and that is what heaven is going to be full of. And don't think just because you're a Seventh-day Adventist that that's what puts you in heaven. We all go to heaven by the grace of God and the grace of God only. Nothing else gets us there. And I truly believe people like my friend Ken at work and my oldest brother Gardner, they will be in heaven even though they're not Adventists because of the love they have in their heart. A love that Christ has taught them even though they may not know that. But one day they will learn what Jesus has done for them.
Wow.
So always remember, you will get help from all different kinds of people. There are angels everywhere. And we thank God. I thank God for these two guys in my life that helped me out the way they did. Always be on the lookout for angels because God has them all over the place and it is fantastic when they come through for us. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for our children. And I ask you, Lord, to please bless the children of the church. Let the children know that there are always good, kind people there to help them, whether it be a church member, a friend from school, or a friend that they meet along the way. Lord, let us always keep our eyes upon heaven. And I pray that our children will become the angels that you have intended them to be. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
It's now time for the morning prayer. And as we prepare for prayer, let us sing the first stanza of number 671. Now, dear Lord, as we pray. far as possible, let us kneel for prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we give you the praise and the honor and the glory for being our God, for being merciful,
yes,
for bringing us safely through another week, and for making us as white as snow, as the snow outside. We pray that you would help us to fully understand just what you have done for us. We give you the praise and the honor and the glory, and we thank you for being our God, for giving us for our sins, and for the many things that you've done for us, for bringing us safely through another week, for being with our families, for being with our friends, for protecting us from disease and sickness that is out there. We ask that you would be with each one of our church family. Guide and protect them. Be with them. Heal them. We know there are those that are sick and suffering. We know that there are those that are recuperating from various things. And we pray that you would be with each one. Provide for their needs. Heal them, whether it be mentally, physically, or spiritually. And again, we give you the honor and the glory, and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
The scriptural focus for this morning comes from two passages, one in Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, and in Matthew chapter 1, verses 22 and 23. I will be reading from the New King James Version, Isaiah 7, verse 14. Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. In Matthew 1, verses 22 and 23. So all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, Behold, the virgin shall be with child, and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which is translated, God with us.
Amen.
The word of the Lord.
Angels, we have heard an angel.
Amen. We praise God and thank God for Nyla ushering us into the presence of God and the wings of music. I want to say that I thank you, all of you here and those remotely, for your support and your prayers for the church, the village church. We thank God that we're still here. And I trust that even though what is happening in our world, that we see we're the Thanksgiving spike, and we are now up against the Christmas holiday, that we will govern ourselves accordingly so that we can continue to survive. We know that God is with us. We thank God we've been open since July 18th, and we're now to the second two Sabbaths. Next week will be our last Sabbath in 2020. And we have met, and God has kept us and brought us, and we just praise God for that. Okay. Not only that, I am really, really blessed and honored by the sacrifices of the congregation in giving. You know, we have seen over $20,000 more in our tithe over the previous year. You know, we're somewhat behind in our local church budget, but we praise God that we can still meet our financial obligations. And we know that as God bless us, we will continue to support God's cause sacrificially. I also want to say thanks to those who lead out in the Sabbath school, Sister Charlene and the team, and the great work that you have done during this time, and all those in the various ministries just to keep it going, the ministry team. But, you know, next Sabbath is 13th Sabbath, and we just want to promote the mission offering. I know, yes, we do have a lot of needs here in North America, but I am a beneficiary of the mission offering, because I thank God that for the mission offering that, you know, the Advent message found my mama, an orphan, and my daddy way up in the bushes. The message came, and thank God they accepted it, and it has been a blessing. It's a blessing in our lives. It's a blessing to be a Christian Seventh-day Adventist, because a Seventh-day Adventist brings the education and the development of the entire human person. And we praise God for that, and I want to thank you. We thank you that for the evangelism team. You know, we have, even though it's COVID, we've been on online and Zooming, and we praise God that we, out of the forecasting hope, we have two candidates to be baptized next Sabbath. So next Sabbath is a big baptismal service. As a matter of fact, we have three candidates next Sabbath, so two baptisms. There is one in the morning and one in the afternoon. And so we are having baptisms here, and we are endeavoring to follow the protocols so that we can be safe. But we thank God that the church continues to grow. And next week we will celebrate. We will celebrate with Ilana and her family. Ilana is getting baptized, and we praise God. Ilana has grown up with us, and so we just thank God for the family, and that Ilana has decided to surrender her heart to Jesus. And so we pray that all will go well And we praise God for the family. Shall we pray? Father, as we open your word, speak, O blessed Master. Have mercy on this feeble lump of clay and use it this one more time for your glory. I pray in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. I should say, I forgot to say thank you for the beautiful cards that you sent me and my family, and we truly appreciate it. The word of the Lord continues to say that, therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will be with a child and give birth to a son, and will call his name Emmanuel. There is a great yearning inside every person to know God. From the very beginning of time, we were made to know God. And there is something in us that wants to know the Creator. We yearn to know that God has broken through into our world. It is not enough to know that God is up there or out there somewhere. We want to know that God has come down to where we are, that God knows where we live, that God knows our name, that God knows and cares about us, that God has walked the lonesome valley the same way we do. We want to know that we are not alone in the universe. Now, I remember reading in that book, Alone with God, and the author was defining loneliness and aloneness. And the author defined loneliness as not having anyone with which to interact. But then there is aloneness, that no one to interact at your level or in your space, wherever you are, and there's nobody that interact with you, understanding that, and you can suffer from aloneness. But we're talking about loneliness today, and the prophets spoke of this universal yearning in the heart. Joel spoke of it, Malachi, Hosea, Jeremiah, Daniel, and Zechariah, but no one spoke more eloquently than Isaiah. And so 700 years before the birth of Jesus, during the reign of King Ahaz, Isaiah predicted the birth of one who would be coming, that God coming to dwell with men. Isaiah 7 and verse 14 predicts an absolutely stunning event. A virgin would conceive, something, this thing that had never happened before and has never happened since, and give birth to a son named Emmanuel. And from that title comes one of the most beloved Christmas carols, O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel, that mourns in lonely exile here until the Son of God appear. O come, thou rod of Jesse, free thine own from Satan's tyranny. From the depths of hell thy people save, and give them victory over the grave. O come, thou dayspring, come and cheer our spirits by thine advent here. Disperse the gloomy clouds of night, and death's dark shadows put to flight. O come, thou key of David, come and open wide our heavenly home. Make safe the way that leads on high, and close the path to misery. O come, desire of nations, bind in one the hearts of all mankind. Bid thou our sad division cease, and be thyself king of peace. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. Emmanuel comes from the Hebrew Emmanuel, from the Greek, but the meaning is the same. From Isaiah to Matthew. And now we can run the clock 700 years, and you come to the moment when Joseph, having discovered that Mary is pregnant, and suspecting the worst, decides to give her a private divorce to spare her from public shame. The angel of the Lord came to him in a dream with the reassuring news that the baby inside her womb was not the product of fornication, but had been conceived by the Holy Spirit. The angel instructs Joseph to call the baby Jesus, which means Savior, because he will save his people from their sins. Then the angel quotes Isaiah 7 and verse 14 with its prophecy of the virgin birth and the name Emmanuel, which means God with us. Now, of all the names of Jesus, perhaps none is more meaningful than Emmanuel, because it gives us his ultimate identity. He is God come down from heaven in the form of a tiny baby boy. Theologians call this the incarnation, a term that means to take on human flesh, to be born as a human. And John 1 and verse 14 tells us that the Word, that is Christ, became flesh and lived among us. The Word, which was God, wrapped himself in human flesh. In the morning, when we get up sometimes and we're cool and cold, and we wrap a robe around us. But in the same way, the Son of God descended from heaven to earth, wrapped himself in the frail body of a tiny Jewish baby in a stable in a little town, Bethlehem, in a forgotten corner of the Roman Empire called Judea. And somebody said, God did not send Christ to us. God came to us in Christ. Jesus Christ is God in the flesh. This tiny, helpless baby is the God who created the universe. He came from his side to our side without ever leaving his own side. I don't know about you, but I think that's a mind-blowing miracle. No wonder when John Wesley, laying dying in 1791, he rose up in his sleep, longed to open his eyes, and he exclaimed, "The best of all is God is with us." And then he closed his eyes and died. Yes, friends, I want to declare that Emmanuel, God with us, is an antidote to loneliness. The first word is God. It precisely identifies the baby born in Bethlehem as the divine Son of God who came from heaven to earth. And the Bible tells us in 1 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 16 states that God was manifest in the flesh. One modern translation says that Christ appeared in human form. That means that whatever else we may say, Jesus Christ is more than a mere human. He was truly, isn't that what Ellen White says? He was verily God as if he were not man. And he was verily man as if he were not God. Human, his ultimate identity goes far beyond humanity. He was God come down to earth in the form of a baby born of a virgin. And hear me, in recent years, I have come to understand that this doctrine has huge importance to Christian faith. Hear me. In many ways, this is the central doctrine, and everything else flows from it. If you can believe that God was born in human form from the womb of a virgin, you will have no trouble with the concept of walking on water. Compared to the incarnation, healing the sick and raising the dead isn't hard to believe either. And the resurrection itself makes perfect sense once you understand who Jesus really is. Now, make no mistake that this truth is fundamental, is absolutely non-negotiable. And I like what my favorite preacher, C.D. Brooks, says, if you try to understand it, you lose your mind. But if you don't believe it, you lose your soul. This is a fundamental truth. You must believe that Jesus Christ is God manifest in the flesh. You must believe that the baby born in Bethlehem is more than just another baby, that he really and truly is the Son of God in human form. The Word made flesh and living among us. And if you do not believe that, you deny the fact that you're a Christian. And the truth is, if it is fundamental to Christian faith and you reject it, I can tell you that you may not get into heaven. Because the Bible says there is no other name given among men, Acts 4:12, whereby we must be saved. Doesn't matter what else you believe about Jesus. If you deny the incarnation, you are not a Christian. This is one of those rare points where all major Christian groups agree. And so the question of who Jesus really is touches the issues of really importance. Every year we sing, "Who is he in yonder stall?" That's the most important question. The whole world, who is that baby in the manger? Is he the Son of God from heaven? Or is he someone else? Yes, the chorus proclaims our answer. "Tis the Lord, our wondrous story. Tis the Lord, the King of glory. And at his feet we humbly fall. Crown him. Crown him, Lord of all." Not everyone believes that, but we do. He's Emmanuel, God with us. And we gladly commit all that we are, all that we have to him. But he's not only a son. The Bible says that God with us is also a shepherd. The second word, Emmanuel, reminds us that Jesus is not only God in the flesh, he's also a shepherd we need when trouble come our way. And ironically, we need this truth more than ever at Christmas time. This is a lonely time of the year for many people. And COVID-19 makes it even more lonelier. And in the midst of sometimes of the laughter, there is pain and sadness and grief and many reminders of broken relationships. Some family reunions are like war zones. And much of the drinking that is done is not so much drinking because we're happy, but drinking to cover pain. And most people feel exhausted and stressed out as the big day approaches. There's an enormous pressure to find money to buy presents, to make our loved ones happy. Have you done all your Christmas shopping yet? 2 weeks ago in the snowstorm, as I tried to get home, slipping and sliding around, I saw all those Amazon vans all over the place, trying to get the presents to deliver before Christmas. And I'm telling you, friends, people are nice at Christmas time. Yet I was cold and I drove to a Dunkin' Donut. And I was buying a small hot chocolate. And when I got up to the window, the attendant told me, the person ahead paid for your hot chocolate. As if I knew, I would have ordered a large. People are just nice. And when I was so happy, I went home and I told my wife about it. She said, did you pay for the person behind you? I said, no. She said, you didn't pass it on. I said, well, I gave the attendant the money I had. I gave her as a tip. So I pass on the tip. But people are very nice. But then it can also be difficult. Because if we feel troubled this time of the year, we must want to be reminded that the Lord knows all about our troubles. We can say it more forcefully that Jesus knows what others do not know about you. He knows all the hidden secrets, the inner fears, the unspoken doubts, about what tomorrow may bring. He knows the whole truth about you and me. And the truth is, he loves us anyway. Hallelujah. So, as we go through this time of the year, some of us will have to walk through some valleys. Valley of pain, valley of loved ones suffering, valley of bad health, valley of failing marriage, valley of children in trouble, valley of broken promises and failed relationship, valley of career disappointment, valley of financial crisis, valley of temptation, valley of bitterness. Whatever the valley you may be walking through, the Lord knows who you are and where you are. And I'm here to tell you that you are not lost and you are not forgotten. If there's anything else I learned during this COVID time, is the truth of the sovereignty of God. That behind everything, there is a God. And God is working out God's will. And even though I don't understand, that's what keeps me going, knowing that there is a God who is working out God's will. And God, I may not understand, but I know you are there. And if you were not there, I would say, stop this earth and let me off. And that trust in God has settled it for me. That God is working out God's will. I don't know what tomorrow holds, but I know who holds tomorrow. And underneath that phrase, the Lord reigns. Yes, despite COVID-19 and all the pain and suffering that exists in the sin-cursed world, God still reigns over heaven and earth. And I know who holds tomorrow, and if I know that, then I don't worry about what's going to happen to my family and my friends. They're going to be all right because God is going to see that that is. And the familiar words of Psalm 23 comes to me, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Verse 4, do you know the most wonderful word in that beloved psalm? Is that little word, you. I don't know if you've ever noticed that David, he changes his mode of address when he talks about the Lord. And in the first verses, he refers to God in the third person. He makes me to lie down. He guides me. He speaks of God in a formal way. He. But when he comes to the darkest, saddest, most fearful moments of life, David's experience of God becomes very personal. You are with me. It's no longer he. Now, God of the universe has become David's personal shepherd. And when I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you, Lord, walk with me. I'm not alone. I'm not abandoned. I don't have to make the final journey on my own. Thank God for the word, you. And it's a promise we can count on in the saddest moments of life. As the gospel song says, I don't have to cross Jordan alone. No, you don't. The Lord will go with you. He will be by your side. And when the dark currents rise around you, the Lord himself will carry you safely to the other side. You know that a lot of people have it in their offices, the footprints on the sand of time. Walking with the Lord. But then there was a time when there were two sets of footprints, but there was a time when there's only one set of footprints. And the burden asked, God, where were you when I was going through the terrible, tough time? And God said, my child, when it was hardest on you, the one set of footprint you saw was because I picked you up in my arms and carried you. Those footprints are mine, not yours. Yes, friends, when we go through tough times, Emmanuel, God with us, is a shepherd. But finally, the angel told Joseph the name of the baby because he will save his people from their sins. Matthew 1:21. Thou shalt call his name Jesus. That was probably the first verse I can remember learning in my Sabbath school as a child. Matthew 1:21, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. In Luke 2:11, the angel announced, today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. Now, you will never understand who Jesus is until you realize that Jesus came to save you from your sins. That is why he lived. That's why he died. That's why he rose from the dead. The Bible says he came to seek and to save that which was lost. And he saved all those who trust in him. Hear me. If our greatest need had been education, God would have sent a teacher. If our greatest need had been money, God would have sent a banker. If our greatest need had been advice, would send a counselor. If our greatest need had been pleasure, God would have sent an entertainer. But since our greatest need is forgiveness, God sent a Savior. Hallelujah. His name is Jesus. He's Christ the Lord, the Son of God who came from heaven to earth. And that brings me right back to the doctrine of the incarnation. Who is that baby celebrated during Christmas? And this familiar carol puts it, this is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the son of Mary. He's the divine Son of God from heaven, who in his earthly birth took on fully human nature. I can't wrap my mind around that. All that God is and all that man is meet in perfect union in Jesus Christ. He's fully God and he's fully man. The God-man who came to earth to save us from our sins. And for those who face loneliness during this season of the year, I encourage you to take comfort in this fact. God's answer to loneliness is not a theory. It is not an abstract doctrine or a book to read or a seminar to attend. It's not a better job, more friends, another movie to watch, or another song to sing. It's not even the beauty of the sunrise or sunset. God's answer to loneliness is wrapped up in a person, Jesus Christ. He's a friend who sticks closer than a brother. He is the only one who you will never leave you nor forsake you. Loneliness can be overcome through personal relationship with Jesus. And so my question is, do you know him? Do you know Jesus? All that God has to say to us can be wrapped up in one word, Jesus. And not just any Jesus, but only the Lord Jesus Christ revealed in the New Testament. He alone is Lord from heaven. He alone can save us. All that God has for you and me is wrapped up in his Son. No matter what difficulties we face and the decision we must make, in the end, God leads us back to the simple one-word answer, Jesus. Still the answer for the world today. You know, in an interview, as I close, PBS News, Billy Graham said that he hoped that the last word he uttered before dying was simply this, Jesus. And we can't do any better than that. Mrs. White, when she was dying, in her closing days, she said, I know in whom I have believed. Confidence in Jesus. And so, friends, as the song said, take Jesus, take the name of Jesus with you. Child of weakness and of woe, yes, it will comfort you, guide you, keep you. Jesus. Sometimes, yes, we need some flesh to connect. I heard the term this week, driving. They say that some of us, we often suffer from touch hunger. Hunger to be touched. And it's hard. You know, when I went to pastor in Brockton, I went after I preached my first sermon and I stood at the the door welcoming, you know, the women were hugging and kissing me. And I was stiffened up because I didn't expect it. But after spending some time in the congregation and learning that this is the French culture, and some of them would kiss me on both cheeks, you know? And after a while, I loved it. And I would look forward to Sabbath just to get that hug and that kiss. Somebody hugged me and kissed me. Oh, special. And so when it comes now to COVID-19 and we can't hug, it hurts. It hurts. Because that hunger for touch. But I thank God that there is hope. There is a vaccine. And I pray that next year, this time, we'll be able to hug again. We'll be able to touch again. We'll be able to sing all the stanzas of the hymn again. Because Jesus is coming. Friends, this is not heaven, but Jesus is coming. And so I thank God that God didn't send an angel, because an angel would never meet our need. God didn't say, read a book, as if book alone could save us. When we were far gone in sin and hopelessly lost, when there was no hope, when we were doomed to eternal judgment, God came to us in the person of Jesus Christ. God didn't forget us, and God will never forget us. You know, this morning, as I sat praying, a message came up on my phone, and it was a mother saying, Pastor, this is who I am. Please do not forget to pray for my son. A mother got that burden. Pastor, pray for my son. And it reminds me that when God says, can a mother forget her child? I will never forget you. A mother. I always say Mother's Day, big day. Father's Day, okay. There is something about a mother's love that is different from a father's love. My daddy never hugged me, but that was how life was in the islands. Tough love. But as I grow older, I realize my father loved me, but just didn't know how to express it. Didn't know. And I have to forgive him and hope that I don't pass this on to the next generation. So we learn what to do and what not to do, but a mother's love. My mother, I knew my mother loved me because my mother nurtured me. I could sit on her lap and she would hug me. She would squeeze me and say, boy, you're getting fat. Wonderful. Just to be touched by a mother. God says, can a mother forget her child? Wherever you are, you may be by yourself right now, but I just want to assure you that God will never forget you. God will never abandon you. God is never guilty of child abandonment. And God has no grandchildren, all children. You're a child of the King. Keep up the faith. Father, we thank you for your word. God, we thank you for the assurance. God, with us, we're never alone. May you be with us during this Christmas time. Bless your people. Keep us safe. Keep us healthy. We pray and thank you for hearing us. In the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen.
The name of Jesus is so sweet. I love its music to repeat. It makes my joys full and complete. The precious name of Jesus. Jesus, oh how sweet the name. Jesus, every day the same. Jesus, let all saints proclaim his worthy praise forever.
We collect the offering at the end, but I would just like to read a blessing on it. And the blessing comes from Psalm 96. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, O families of the people. Give to the Lord the glory and strength. Give to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. Oh, worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Special emphasis is placed on the budget. So as we give, let's remember that. I have to say, personally for me, I have never been an online giver, but COVID has forced us to change our giving habits. And I have become an online giver. And you know what? I've come to like it. It's easy. You just go to the church website and you do everything there. But those of you who are not doing that, then we collect the offering at the end. So please be generous. And you can also mail it in. So let's have a special prayer on the offering. Lord, we thank you. We praise you for being Lord, for being our Savior. We pray your special blessings on our gifts to you. May they be used wisely for your cause. In Christ's name.
Amen. Thank you. us from falling, and to present us faultless before his majestic throne. To the only wise God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever, let the church say.
Amen.